the hearts. Sing to the choir. Staring down a loaded gun like some white dove on the wire. Talking with the ghost. Spinning on the page. Floating through the friendly fire. The white lights of the stage.
So much, Matt. That was great. Our speaker this morning is Mandisa Thomas, and she will give a talk entitled How to Identify White Supremacist Ideals. She is a native of New York City and founder of Black Nonbelievers, Inc. Ms. Thomas currently serves on the boards of American Atheists and the American Humanist Association. She's also an active speaker and has represented at conferences and conventions for the Freedom From Religious Foundation, Secular Student Alliance, and many others. Ma'am, you need a vacation. You do too much. But without further ado, I'd like to welcome Mandisa Thomas.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Good. Thank you very much. It is an absolute pleasure to be back here with Houston Oasis. Thank you. And it is so wonderful to see so many familiar faces, some of you who I am very well acquainted with on social media. We have connected through various in-person and online events. And again, it is just such a pleasure to see each and every one of you, many who I have grown to know and love in this community. But today, are y'all ready to talk about a very serious subject? And it is very serious and important to our community, just as much as it is on the larger scale and what we see in the media and in the news. But we have to address it here within our own community to make sure that we are not continuing to make these mistakes. So the title of the talk is Addressing White Supremacy in the Secular Community and What to Do About It. So before we get into that, just a little bit about me. This picture, in case you don't know me on social media, is the most recent billboard campaign I had the pleasure of participating with as a part of the Freedom From Religion Foundation's I'm Secular and I Vote campaign, which was a billboard and newspaper ad, and that's me standing by the Atlanta billboard. And the photographer for the head photo is in the back, Mr. Karama. Thank you so much for taking that picture. So Like Jacob said, I am the founder and president of Black Nonbelievers, Incorporated, which is headquartered in the Atlanta, Georgia area. I'm going to get this out of here. I need some movement. Got it.
Sorry, I should have put this on.
Now you tell me. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. Yes, I was born and raised in New York City, moved to the Atlanta, Georgia area when I was 21. I will be 46 in September, so I have been there for a very long time. I was actually not formally raised religious. I was born and raised into Black conscious community, learned a lot about Black history and culture growing up, and I also learned about institutional racism, white supremacy, and injustice. So that was basically ingrained into my, it was just basically ingrained into me, and it helped shape me into the type of activist that I am today. For a very long time, about 4 years ago now, I transitioned to full-time activism after working as the event services manager at the Centers for Disease Control for almost 10 years, and also developing Black Nonbelievers as an organization, and that is in addition to my board work. I also have a family, so yes, maybe I do need another vacation, but no. That was really when I determined, or it was determined that this is where my life's work should be, or at least part of it, because it became so, so important. As mentioned, I currently serve on the boards for American Atheists and the American Humanist Association, as well as an organization called Humanist Global Charity. And a few awards and recognitions. I was the recipient of the Secular Student Alliance's Backbone Award in 2019, as well as the Free Thought Heroine Award, which is presented by the Freedom From Religion Foundation that same year. I was the UU Humanist Association's Person of the Year in 2018. I was the 2020 co-recipient of the Harvard Humanist of the Year Award, along with Sikivu Hutchinson and Ijoma Oluwo. And if you have never ever heard Sikivu speak, I suggest having her as a future speaker here with Oasis. And most recently, this year, I was a recipient of the Irving and Annabelle Wolfson Award, which was presented by the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Worcester in Massachusetts. And finally, I am a certified humanist celebrant, so I can perform life ceremonies for fellow atheist humanists and beyond. And I always say that I did not get into this work for the recognition, but it is nice when it comes. So before we begin, I want everyone to note that I am not a subject matter expert on this, but I play one on TV. Totally kidding, but it is through my extensive work in this movement and my experience, observation, and engagement that does allow me to speak directly on this issue and that my points be taken seriously because they are valid. So I like to include definitions in my presentations, especially for a topic as serious as this. So the definition of white supremacy is the belief that the white race is inherently superior and that white people should have control over people of other races. And also, it's the social, economic, and political systems that collectively enable white people to maintain power over those races. So I think it's important to understand that we are not just simply talking about individuals. We're talking about institutions. Without us even realizing it. So I want us to look at white supremacy from that lens. It's going to be very, very important. Now, where have we seen extreme and gross displays of white supremacy recently? January 6th, the insurrection in Washington, D.C., when we saw those folks storm the Capitol, which resulted in some tragic deaths. We also recently saw this in the Buffalo, New York mass murders on May 14th, where that young gentleman went into the grocery store and deliberately shot black people. And also, we can reference the overturning of the Roe versus Wade decision, where we are seeing Supreme Court justices who are invoking their Christian values into reproductive justice and in the law, which will impact many people, but particularly people of color, and most explicitly, women of color. However, I must state here, we have to ask these questions. Can white supremacy be subconscious? Can black, indigenous, and people of color be complicit in white supremacy? Can women, LGBTQ plus folks, and other marginalized groups uphold white supremacist culture? And last but not least, can atheists, humanists, freethinkers, et cetera, be accomplices to white supremacy? The answer to all of that is yes. So again, as we are speaking about these things institutionally, we have to think about how all of us in some way may be responsible for perpetuating and upholding white supremacist ideals and I wouldn't say policies, but in some cases that is true. And I also have to look at myself. And I was indoctrinated as well. I didn't escape it. We do live in a still very, very, very highly patriarchal and white supremacist and Eurocentric valued system. So all of us have been impacted by that. So the takeaway is not that you should simply feel bad about that, but to perhaps think about the subliminal ways that we may be perpetuating this and what we can do to try to change that. And one very recent example of someone who upholds white supremacy as a person of color is this guy, who, again, one of the Supreme Court justices, whose decision was a nail in the coffin for that reversal. So when we say all our skin folk ain't kinfolk, we mean it. So here are 10 ways that you may be upholding white supremacy as a non-believer. And as I go through each of these points, again, I'd like for us to just be objective, you know, think about it, and try not to get defensive, but again, just, you know, take a look, listen, and, you know, process and see what we can do about it. So in our community, we pride ourselves on our intellectual capability, how many books that we may have in our library or how many we may reference. However, there is a lot of appeal to white male authority in our community. Now, of course, we look at this historically because those were often the voices who represented our, you know, our interests and our communities. However, with the growing diversity of our community, and now that there is more information out there, when there is a constant appeal to white male authority, whether it is simply in our community or any references or any individuals that who you hold near and dear, that could be a problem. Also, constant appeal to academic scholarship, especially white and male. And no, I am not standing here saying that we should throw out all of the people who have worked hard for their education and to be accredited in their fields. However, there are many people on the ground, some of whom may not have had the access to education like many others, which does include people of color. It does not mean that what they do or how they work is any less credible or valid. And I think we need to be taking that into consideration when it comes to organizers, people who are getting things done. They may not necessarily have the academic backing or credentials, but again, we do just as much work. And that should never go unnoticed. Definitely ignoring or dismissing institutional disparities that black, indigenous, and people of color endure. You are probably seeing this every day, especially in the state of Texas. And we are seeing it not only across the United States, but across the globe. We have, you know, and let's take the black non-religious demographic in particular. We have higher rates of concealment due to the overwhelming of impact of religion in our communities, which means that it is much, much more challenging for us to openly identify and for organizations like ours to do the work that we need to because of those factors. So this is one example. This is, y'all are a good example of trying to be more inclusive, be more diverse, and change your practices. However, there are many other organizations that need a lot more work. And to ignore those factors as to why there may not be more people of color in this room, maybe more young people, maybe more LGBTQ folks, you cannot ignore those factors just because you do have, you know, humanism is incorporated into your way of being. However, it is not as simplistic as just kumbaya, everyone come together. It's not that simple. It's also not that pretty of a picture. So we have to be mindful about ignoring that. Also, inserting your opinion where it may not belong. I know as a community, we love to discuss things. Some of us may love to debate more than others. And there is a time and a place for that, especially when our rights are under attack. However, even within our own communities, and this goes into, first, you have your people who ignore what BIPOC people go through, but then when we speak on it, or if there are issues that directly pertain to us, that is not always an invitation for non-POC to insert your opinion. That might be the time to listen and take the information in, but there are going to be times, especially when it comes to, I say, LGBTQ and people of color, institutional racism, sometimes you need to watch that. Sometimes it might just be good to just take a step back and just listen, or even if you don't agree, you simply just don't have the right to butt in. Also, dismissing the importance of anti-racism work, particularly critical race theory. I can't tell you how many times I have seen a number of people who outright dismiss critical race theory. They're dismissing it as, we're teaching white people to hate themselves. Or that, you know, we're just angry in some way that it's not valid in any way. And the same approach that we take to religion, doing research, compiling evidence, is the same way everyone should be doing that when it comes to economic injustice, when it comes to racial injustice, even environmental justice, which is a core passion for many in our communities. However, what is ignored at times is the racism in environmental justice. So the same way, the same evidentiary and verified approach that we take to religion and these other factors that are near and dear to us, certainly you want to make sure you are doing your research, gathering that information, and understanding it better. Encroaching on BIPOC spaces and either being voyeuristic or authoritarian. Now, in the 11 years that I have been active in this community, there have been a number of people who have, you know, who have found Black nonbelievers and other groups that are specifically targeting people of color. And while we don't mind input, while we don't mind the engagement, when you're coming from a place that is uninformed, as well as a defensive approach, and you come to spaces of people of color, and it may not be the information that you're necessarily used to, it's important that you don't allow your defenses to make you sound like you know better. And also, it's not a good opportunity to just simply sit and just learn from all of us, or to just simply lurk. If you are going to be a part, and then it may be good to, again, it has to take a combination of all of that. Constantly, but also too, we have to consider, constantly expecting Black, Indigenous people of color to educate you, especially without compensation. In this, many of the activists of color, there are a number of us who we don't mind giving that information, and we understand that as communities, there is still a lot that there's still a lot that we have to do to grow each other, and we realize that resources can be very scarce. But it can only take just a little bit, you know. It only takes a little to give to people who are talking about these issues, some of us who may be formally educated on them, but also some of us who have lived them. And thinking that reading books resolves everything. Of course, like I said, I am not saying that we throw away all of the literary works, all of the education, but after you read that material, after you take it in, how are you putting it into practice? That is a very, very important component to this work, because we're seeing now a growth in anti-racism education, reading on the historical factors, which are absolutely important. But I tend to be a person of action. It's like, what do you do after that? What are you doing with the information that you are learning? And are you taking it in to actually help people, or is it just simply for your own benefit? And lack of financial support for our organizations, that is something that should be considered. I know that I can say that Black Nonbelievers, even with the popularity that we have gained, we still are working at a disproportionate amount compared to other, especially national organizations. We are actually doing a lot with what we take in, which I'm just saying could be more. We can certainly do a lot more with more financial support. And even though we appreciate the moral support, we appreciate, you know, keep doing what you're doing, we can't keep doing what we do if we are lacking in that financial aspect. And last but not least, the All Lives Matter and Back the Blue crowd. I don't know what else I can say about that. Of course, we are not saying that, yes, we do know that all lives matter, but clearly, as we have seen in recent history, there is clearly a disregard for Black lives, for LGBTQ lives, for the lives of children. So all lives can't matter until our lives matter. So I know that is probably, you've probably heard that before, but it doesn't hurt to reiterate it. So the first time I debuted this talk, at the American Atheist Convention this year in Atlanta. And when I tell you that both American Atheists and the American Humanist Association shared slides from this talk. And for those of you who are on social media, especially Twitter, you know how much of a shit show it can be. So I titled this slide, "Hell Have No Fury, Like Some Privileged Atheists and Humanists Being Called Out on Their Shit." Because you had some folks there who said that American Atheists should apologize me for such anti-illogical, anti-all the things. Well, of course, they didn't see the talk. But these are people who are used to stirring up this nonsense online. And there was one guy who, you know, a couple of people who made some very, very disparaging comments. However, if I wasn't used to getting disparaging comments, that might have been more upsetting. However, it's very interesting the slant that they put on it, that, you know, I was being the racist one. You know, like, how dare I attack the institution of academia, especially as a Black woman? But guess what? Like I said, my 11 years, my activism, my engagement in this movement does allow me to speak to the experiences and observations and what also can be a turnoff to many people of color and other white allies if your groups are not taking this seriously. So, how can we dismantle white supremacy in our community? Dismantle doesn't mean it happens overnight. It doesn't even mean that it will all go away, period. But how can we resolve and try to dismantle it? So first, this sounds, this may sound contradictory to what I said about education, but that is important. It is important, it is crucial though that you are not expected to be active. Mistakes, importantly correct them. So if someone is telling you that something that you either did or something your organization did may be a problem, it's good to take that and just acknowledge and accept it. And this is just a good rule of thumb for people in general. When you know better, you do better. And that's a simple motto. Your spaces, your organizations, and make the improvements. I think it's important for us to know that we are and so in a lot of ways with hospitality and community and coming from the hospitality world. Friendly and fair. Something that education will never teach you. These are life skills. Refuse to learn or to for people. It's okay to tell people, okay, you can do that, just not here. Also, when Black, Indigenous people of color are speaking, please listen carefully and do take us seriously. I can't tell you how many times I or another person of color, especially a woman, has made a valid point. But as soon as either a man, especially a white man, says the same thing, oh, now it's law. And this goes along with unlearning the patriarchy and white supremacy that tells or that informs that women's voices are not as important. So that's something to think about. Oh, and also let us do our work, but do be ready to jump in when needed. So we are talking about decentering Eurocentricity, decentering certain voices who we hold near and dear, and also allowing for those of us who traditionally have not had the opportunity to be heard. You definitely putting us more in the forefront. Do offer extra support for BIPOC organizations and initiatives. I'm pretty sure there are plenty here in the Houston area, especially that are doing anti-racism work. If you are so inclined to support them, then please do. And also be consistent and genuine. None of this works if your heart and mind is not in it. Nobody's saying that you absolutely have to care about these things the same way we do. But if you do, and I know many people in this room and in our organizations, your hearts are in the right place, everyone that's here. And especially if there are organizations that directly benefit you, that directly represent you, do be consistent and genuine with you know, with your support, with your, you know, with your time, with your participation. That is a hard thing to do at times. It really, really is, but it is necessary. This is a favorite quote from one of my favorite new bands called Moonchild. This is from their show that I attended in Atlanta, Georgia in October of 2019. They are a very amazing band. If you've never heard of them, I highly encourage you to listen to their music. But they are very big on supporting initiatives for people of color and also that uplift the voices of Black people in particular. And they have a very simple phrase, spend your privilege. Now, if you can acknowledge that you are a person of privilege, and this is not relegated to white people. There are other people of color who have a certain amount of privilege. Sure, it may be disproportionate, but they still do. So the best way that if you but putting in conclusion, or one of the conclusions, is up to us. And I will say that in these 11 years that I have been active, things are getting better in our community. They really are. There are some folks in recent years, particularly leaders, who were proven to be predators. They were proven to be abusive. And guess what? The organizations of which they were a part of made the right decisions to get rid of them, which allowed more people to participate and take the organization seriously because they know that they are being listened to. Things are getting better. However, there are still a fair number of people in our communities who may be upholding and perpetuating these white supremacist ideals that are problematic. And if we are going to be better in religious communities, then we can, and we are, but we also can also lead by example. Point the finger to say, well, we're not like them, but to continue on a positive trajectory and be willing to sit, you know, with discomfort at times and say, okay, this may need to be improved. And there's no age limit on that. You know, we are constantly learning, especially as many of us come from communities that did not support critical thinking, that did not support progressive measures. Every day, and it can be challenging. It can be very, very hard to unlearn not just the information, but also the practices. But again, it's with people who are like-minded and who share the same values. If you're a member of the American Humanist Association, or if you've ever seen the 10 commitments to humanism, a lot of them are very action-based. They are actually values which impact communities, improve communities, as well as economic. It is more than just simply us talking about it. It's what we can do about it. And I love this picture because there are many ways we can do this work that go beyond our own community. It is very, very action-based, and we can do it. You know, I cannot emphasize enough how challenging it can be for us. If this is, then we just have to do it. So here are some recommended resources, and some of you may be acquainted with Dr. Anthony Penn, who is here in Houston. He has a book called When Colorblindness Isn't the Answer, Humanism and the Challenge of Race. Humanists in the Hood, Unapologetically Black, Feminist, and Heretical by Sakivu Hutchinson. And also Justice-Centered Humanism by Roy Speckhart, the former executive director of the American Humanist Association. And so with that, I would like to quickly encourage you to follow and subscribe to BN on social media. We are on Facebook, Black Nonbelievers. We're on Instagram at Be Nonbelievers, Inc., Twitter at Black Nonbelievers, the B and the N are capitalized, and I thought it was worth mentioning that the former leader of the organization actually, after the first talk, took to the YouTube waves and degraded and critiqued our number of Twitter followers. So help us get our Twitter following up so that we can be more credit and valid. No, I just had to put that in there. But yes, please do follow us on Twitter. And also like and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We have quite a bit of content from previous events on our YouTube channel. And if you, it's really good for getting more insight into the subject matter of the challenges that we face and also hearing them from our perspective. And of course, I invite you to donate and support Black Nonbelievers. We are a 501c3 nonprofit organization. You can go to our website to donate, and if you are so inclined, you can also make your contributions monthly or recurring. We are on Cash App. You can designate us as a beneficiary on Amazon Smile. And if your place of employment has a workplace giving program, a charitable program, you can select us. All you need is our tax ID number, which is on our website. And of course, we encourage donations at our table in the back. We do have some swag if you are interested in purchasing. So please, you know, please do come by the table. And I like to share about our upcoming events. Myself and Karama are wearing the 2021 Women of Color Beyond Belief Conference shirts. This is fast approaching. The dates are September 30th through October 2nd. All of the presenters and the producers are women of color who are non-religious. And we have another fantastic lineup. This is our third year. And if you can't make it in person, you can sign up to stream it online. The in-person component, we are now working on a service project with Go Humanity on a meal packing project. So we encourage you, please, 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 you can go directly to the Women of Color Beyond Belief website or through Black Nonbelievers to register in person, online, and just to show your support. And there's also, we are still taking registrations for our annual cruise convention, which takes place from November 27th to, well, the entire convention takes place from November 26th through December 3rd, but there is still time to register if you are interested in attending. And the one thing I always like to end with, now started ending with this, come experience the being difference. There is, when the way we do community is special, it's not just simply unique, it is special. And that is something that I'm very, very proud of. I'm proud of our organizers, I'm proud of our members, I'm proud of our supporters. We can look to history and take a look at the number of white allies who actually died in a name for civil rights and human rights. And other people, especially other people of color, and just people in general who gave their lives. And I'm not standing here saying that that has never happened, but for those of you who aren't aware of that, make yourself aware and even be ready to jump in, not necessarily to die for it, but jump in and do even a quarter of what they did. Because again, we are all, really are all in this together. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mandisa. It's been said that if you want a better society, build one. You and your organization are doing exactly that. Very much. And yet, another way to support Black Nonbelievers is merch, shirt, or anything like that to help her do her tireless and endless work. So we're going to do something a little bit different today. But after, we're going to do a Q&A. The way we're doing it today, just because bound to be so many questions, and for the sake of time, we're going to write your questions on one of the blank spaces in the bulletin, and we'll read them. So we'll take a 5-minute coffee break, and the bulletins and pencils will be right up here. Just write your question, and if you could, keep it as brief as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Excuse me, it seems like confusion. If you have any questions you'd like to ask Mandisa, right up here is where you could write it, or if you have a bulletin.
Test, test.
Hello. If everybody could please find your seats, we'll go ahead and do the Q&A portion. If you went and wrote your question down on paper, please hold it up and come around and collect it.
All right, so we are back for Q&A. Can you tell I've hosted events before? Okay, so are you going to read them, Jacob?
Yeah. Okay, so our first question is, how do you balance genuine anti-racism versus accusations of woke or cancel culture that...
Can you repeat the start of that question again, please?
Yeah. How do you determine genuine anti-racism versus accusations of woke or cancel culture that pundits might speak?
You know, you have to jump out of the gate talking about your worried about cancel culture and now the woke lords and stuff. You're probably not on the right path. So for people who are genuinely lend their hands to it, then it really is about, you know, you can ask the questions and again come in, keep an open mind. And also it's really about, you know, you can always tell who's genuinely active or who really wants to be a part of this, as opposed to those who just come in and just and are just derogatory. You can pretty much tell, or it should be, you know, you should be able to tell. You know, you definitely pay attention to their act or lack thereof, and also how they're engaging people on this subject.
Thank you. And then our last question is, do you see any ways or opportunities to work through or past religion's monopolies on charitable causes?
Do I see a way to, I'm sorry.
It says work past, any ways to work through or past, I think perhaps counter the religious monopoly on charitable causes.
Absolutely. So what we're doing now when it comes to being open and active is gonna make a huge difference. It is, you know, this is work that has to be consistent. It has to go beyond when the major headlines, either when they're yesterday's news. We have to continue to do this work. We often have to do it when there's no one watching, no one looking, because that is when, I tell you, after Obama was elected president, they started ramping up their bases. It really did. And working through all of that does require a critical examination of, once again, how we are treating each other. How, if we are dismissing someone simply, even though unintentionally, either as a person of color, as a woman, or someone who doesn't seem to have all of the either academic, the experience, or even the notoriety, because we are a culture that loves to see, you know, things on a big scale, but tends to ignore people who are often doing things on a small scale or even grassroots. So that is really going to be an important thing for us to do and continue to do it. And if that means working alongside progressive believers at times, if they can see the value in you as a person, especially if you are non-religious and unapologetic, if there's an opportunity for us to do that, then please do. It doesn't mean that we should be conforming to any of that. And I think that as our communities grow, we can become, you know, we are independently doing, you know, creating programs and initiatives. But if we can also give our time and resources and participate with other organizations that are already exist, and they are willing to engage and work with us, then do that. We don't have to reinvent or build a new wheel if there's already one out there. So it's gonna continue. We have to continue to do this work, continue to support it, and just make it better. Learn from our mistakes, because we will all make them. And it's how we recover from that as well that will help.
Okay, thank you so much. Those are all the questions we had. If anyone has a question they didn't get to write, what's the best way to reach you?
You can reach me directly through our website at blacknonbelievers.org. I answer all correspondence personally. And also, you can get in contact with Will or anyone on the Oasis board who has my direct email address if you'd like to ask a question. And that's pretty much the best way.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate everything you talked about today.
Thank you.
So before our performance is the last song, we're going to have a brief preview of next week's talk from our very own CB.
Thank you, Ms. Thomas. Really appreciate it. The reason this is out of the ordinary, but the reason I asked to present briefly what my next talk next week is going to be about is because I think it dovetails nicely with today's topic. For those who do not know, and it seems like most people don't know, this past spring in Orlando, Florida, there was a gathering of people who passed something called the American Conservative Manifesto, which is essentially a new government for the United States of America. And these weren't wackos, these were influential people. I'm going to be reading from that manifesto. I'm also going to be reading a few comments. But before it all, you're going to hear from someone who experienced being entrapped and spied upon by representatives of his own government. And this is firsthand knowledge because the person who's going to be speaking and telling that to you is me, because I have actually experienced that, which has made me a rather bit, as I'm sometimes called at home, fanatical about the subject. So we hope you're here next week. Thank you.
Thank you, CB. Very much looking forward to that talk. So Matt Harlan will sing one more song, and then after that we will have a few announcements. Two more songs.
Well, man, I really the presentation and the talks and the questions a lot. So much so that I had one of the tunes that I was going to play, and it's one that, you know, I like a lot, and but I realize, and I have realized over time that it's not a perfect song. None of them, you know, are, but rather than stand up and try to fix it on the spot, I'll play a different tune. It's kind of like about acknowledging how wrong we can be sometimes, you know. Even though you might be trying to do the best thing you could do, that you know, maybe you need to, as she mentioned, you know, acknowledge how often you might miss the mark and go back and kind of reformulate yourself. So yeah, this tune might be a little bit about that, I think. Pick me up and take me for a ride. Flip me over like a 45. Drag me tumbling through the riptide. I need to look the way I feel tonight. Messed up and twisting on my axis and inhaling lies to find the truth in them. Strung out on pills, feel like heroin. Man, I'm no different than you. I am no different than you. Guides are barely getting by, concealing secrets from our darker sides. Pure to man, wrapped up in infinite supply. Man, I can't stop it, how about you? We are no different. West Virginia to the Golden Coast, thin skin and howling on the radio. No single one of us immune. Who's got got you certain of the world you know. Half stitched together where it seems I'll show. No single one of us in tune. We're just trying to be the best piece we can be. The best piece we can be. The best piece we can be. And find a way to sleep. Best piece we can be. Best piece we can be. The best piece we can be. Don't dig too deep. Ships have sailed away, pretending things should always be this way. The future's coming for you soon. We're so certain of the world we know. Half stitched together where the seams all show. No single one of us in tune. We're just trying the best piece we can be. 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 Best piece we can be.
That makes them think and makes them want to what they learn, you know, their life and into the folks that they talk to, that they could do that. Your songs that say. Up to us to write songs that say that, because, you know, I don't know if protest songs got some, you know, the pop, I guess. It's okay to say in song what you want to have passed along. Thanks for having us here today. Sky's gray, birds are singing songs I'd never heard. I woke up feeling strange, but then that's really not the word. I woke up feeling hungry, I woke up feeling strong. I woke up wondering how we let this linger on so long. So there's a line, a long dividing line. Stretches through the neighborhood, it wrestles in the street. There's a time to put our fears aside and leave our anger lying at their feet. I turned it off, I went outside and called up all my friends, called to my enemies to try and make amends. Drew up all our courage, pushed down all our pain, said some words for those who never get to speak again. So
this song. We used to hear our parents sing before we knew the tune. Yeah, we could lose it all. So everybody has some room.
So much, guys. That was great. Before we get to the end, we have an announcement from our treasurer, Richard Andrews.
Hey, folks. For those of you who are here for the first time, welcome. I hope you come back. Became the treasurer last Thursday. I barely know what I'm doing, and of course, as soon as you hear the word treasurer, you immediately check your to see if anybody's messed with your wallet. So, but I do want to give a brief money chat here. This is a nonprofit organization, Houston Oasis, as you may know. We do pay rent for using this space each week. We pay musicians. We often pay the speakers, depending on the speaker. So if you're able to give, and some people may not be in a position where they can give, and that's okay, your presence here is the most important thing. But if you're able to give, we have a black hat in the back. We also have a number of other ways of giving, which are listed on this item, like Zelle and Venmo and various other things. So as a treasurer, I believe in maximum transparency for the organization, so the people giving their money know where the money's going and stuff like that, know about the finances of the organization and stuff like that. So I don't have all the access to our systems yet because I just got on board, but I will be giving periodic reports to the organization about the finances of Houston Oasis, as well as to the board, obviously. So thank you very much. There you go.
And we most certainly did not mess with the wallets. You will be swarmed by child cockney pickpockets next week. So lunch today is at Golden Dim Sum. The address is 10800 Bel Air Boulevard. We saw the new people here. Thank you so much for coming. It was great to see everybody here today, and we hope you come to lunch with us. Thank you.